banking. So you'll come out of turn four, and the next thing you will see will be the finish line.
Love this heads-up camera, by the way. We just cut away from it at that moment. But as you can see, the commentator's position, which is just to the left of the camera that was used a few moments ago, is you could almost wipe the sweat off the brow of these guys. They try and use all of the track because it's reasonably narrow, so they want to get the best slingshot they possibly can. And when they sail by those white tables there, you can hear them breathe, even in the atmosphere that's being created here by Martin Too Smooth. These guys are on it, as you can see. They mean business. It is the United States team of Zak Kovalcik and Gavin Hoover. Now, what will they do? It's Zak that's going for this one. Slightly ragged into the turn. There's his first benchmark, and he's way off. He's half a second down already. And it looks like he's questionable gearing.
He's putting some effort into it, though, isn't he?
He's going hell for leather, but it's not pretty. There you go, at 22.339. I wonder whether the split was in error.
Well, the time's wrong there, isn't it?
Oh, there we are, 22.339. I think the first split, maybe I mashed it. We will wait and see. But, well, we're into the 22s already. Well, I wasn't sure about the cadence. Let's have a look at the handover. What do you reckon?
Well, there are a couple of riders that we're not used to seeing. So I certainly haven't seen them in any of the 6 days up until now, two new riders. You see they're, you know, quite ragged on the track, not holding the line very well. But I think they have set the fastest time at the moment. We're just waiting for confirmation of that.
I think they have. So into the 22s right now. And Zak Kovalcik, let's go with that one, shall we, has set a fantastic marker here. Hoover and Kovalcik have got themselves a leading time at the moment, 22.339. It may well be that those Madison times drift away from them, depending on all kinds of things, including atmospherics during the week.
Yep, so they're in the hot seat for now, and that's some haircut, isn't it?
Yeah, well, I'm kind of jealous of it. If I wanted to replicate it, I'd probably just, brush a fox stole and glue it to the top of my head, leaving the sides as they are. But anyway, he knows what he likes, that's for sure, and he likes that haircut. We like that performance. It was an outstanding one, and Zak Kovalcik is there. It's a Zak attack.
Very much so, and they will be in the hot seat. I think they'll be there for quite a while. They put a lot of effort into that race.
Maybe it was a cooking accident. Not quite sure. You know, it's the circle of cool. The further you go around the circle, you just come round to the not cool, and then you can't back up, as Eddie Izzard famously pointed out. Thanks, Eddie, if you're watching. He is a cyclist, you know. Is that Eddie? Meanwhile, track centre, it looks like the beers are flowing. And this is part of six-day racing. It is a festival, after all. You can't watch every minute of all of it. So go and get yourself a bit of snap, as they say in Sheffield. Enjoy yourself. They've been given some mineral water. Well, it's a blue bottle anyway. It's probably Calowa. Don't touch it, fellas. Looks bad, especially if you eat loads of crisps and it all goes. Anyway, you don't want to see it twice. Let's put it there. Some people love it. I digress. John Turner says, this track is tight. Madison looks like rush hour over Blackfriars Bridge. John, I know where you're coming from. And it'll get a bit like that. You wait. Rich Mellon is in the pub. He says, I'll be with you as soon as possible. Rich, he's probably on the bus at the moment.
The team elimination race is very simple. Every second lap, the team at the back of the race is eliminated.
Little toy teaser. A Chris Tickle, I think we can call it. We're always up for a bit of an eliminatory lappage, aren't we not?
Yeah, very much so, and here we go. So this is a Madison race. The riders are carrying out changes, and they're going to put the lights on in a minute, or else it could be interesting.
Everyone in the blue.
Yeah, and So they carry out their Madison changes as normal every time they pass their partner, and every other lap, every 400 metres, a team is eliminated. So the eliminations are coming around even quicker than they were on London at the 6 day a couple of weeks back. So you can see the Spanish riders coming around the outside. No, sorry, that was the riders from Netherlands, Crader and
Terpstra
coming around the outside. So you will hear the bell. So they've got three free laps to start with. Then you will hear the bell, and a rider is eliminated the next time round. And we go all the way down to two riders left.
Bell's been rung. By the way, when we gain laps here in Amsterdam, traditionally there's been a hooter. Sounds like a great big super tanker is arriving. I'm hoping that they're going to be giving us a bit of hootage later on. We'll see when we get to some of the big stuff. There we are. It's a farewell to the Stairway to Heaven, which
Muller
is
Muller
and Graf wearing the red ladder. And in fact, it's Andy Muller that got himself eliminated. They won't be too upset about that because they're given to saving themselves on occasion, blowing very hot and cold. Peaky, I think you might say. A bit like the new Toblerone bar. A little bit of space in between. Well, quite a lot, actually. But they do peak occasionally. I wonder if Toblerone have missed. They should have just put the price up. Keep the shape. Anyway, back to it. And the bell is ringing. Team 11, it's for them that it doth toll. Imhoff and Merguez are out.
Yep, so Imhoff and Merguez eliminated there, and we've got the winners of the flying two-lap time trial at the back in trouble at the moment, and they're going to do well to get themselves out of trouble here. I think they're just going to do it. Nope, they're eliminated. So that was Team 12, Kovalcik and Hoover.
Yes.
They're just going to have to be eliminated and suck it up.
Kovalcik, there we are, also known as Limahl, in our minds anyway. Meanwhile, indoors in Atmosphere Central. Martin Toosmuth is doing his thing at the moment. Kennedy Kessler leads this general classification overall on the lead lap because we had a 40k Madison this afternoon. De Kennedy Depot, Morkov, Hester, Grassman, Bayer, they're all on the lead lap chasing. Labrador and Kautz need to find it. So do the Spaniards and the rest. Tennant and Latham, well, not in a happy place. Graf, Muller, Imhoff and Merguez with Hoover and Kovalcik. I'm just proud I've got it right.
You think you've got it right.
Well, you'll say it's Kovalcik, my friend. I met an American once and he said, my name...
Later in the week, you sit there, you just shut your eyes for a few minutes, you start nodding off and all of a sudden you've got to get back up again.
Doesn't matter how busy it is out there. You've got to be very careful as well that you don't overindulge on the old carbs either because you can suddenly just hit a... just hit a wall of fatigue as you try and digest the whole thing.
Yeah, definitely. You know, you've got to be very careful what you eat, and the swan years there are there to help you out and to give you a little bit of food every now and then, and a bit of black tea with honey in it just to make sure you don't get a sore throat, which is very easy to do on an indoor track with, you know, all the cooking and the dry ice machines and the fumes from the Dernies and everything else flying around.
Do you know about the rather cheeky use of a liquid chocolate machine?
Dread to think.
I've mentioned this, haven't I? it was told to me that the Lugers once arrived for a world championship event in Germany, and there was a liquid chocolate machine inside their little prep room, and they all helped themselves and basically just carved out all of a sudden. That was it. They just had no energy. They couldn't resist. It was as simple as that. Apparently, the Germans had great discipline and didn't run the event. But this is an anecdote from our Luge team. Whether that sort of shenanigans goes on here, I do not know. There are our Derny men. Let's go through them, shall we? Nearest to you, Ron Zylod with his little kick-up. Not sure who Ron Zylod has been paired with at the moment. Looks a bit pensive. Desire Kenny. That's Kelly de Kettler, a bit of a hero jaw upon him. We have Peter Berlaine, the Kaiser, is out there. We're not racing. Oh, yeah, we are. We've got Wally Hubrex, the flying fireman, is here. Old Chubby Chops himself. Well, we'll see whether Wally Hubrex... I use these phrases, of course, with great respect. Well, with affection, let's put it that way. He is... an archetypal pacer, I think it's fair to say. The flying fireman from Antwerp. He takes more air than anyone else out there, but as a result, he's very much favoured as far as the riders are concerned. But there's no favouritism here. You just pick one. Number two, he gets himself Peter Berlaine, the Kaiser. There he is. Well, in fact, it's Christian Dippel. I beg your pardon. Do you know what? They've gone and changed them around. They've changed our numbers. So Chris Dippel, the metronome. That's a small person who goes on the underground. Anyway, so let's see who... Gibby's shaking his head. Marcel Kautz, who's he got? Number three. And who is number three this time? Oh, Wally. He's in the house. My man. Wally's going to win. That's it. Yes, indeed. He's a man who wins stomp pot competitions. Cooking them, that is, not eating. Here is our friend Andreas Graf. Andy looks pensive as he picks number five. And number five will be... It's René Kos. He's got the Kos man. There we are. René Kos, former moto pacer, the world champion, we mentioned back in 1981. Oh, here we are. Nice to see.
At yeah, last, great. Andy great Tennant. To see Andy Tennant on the track, and he's drawn Ron Szilard.
What? Well, he's certainly fresher, Andy Tennant, and Ron Szilard is no mean pacer. There you are. You saw just how pleasant he is when he's smiling. He wears those sort of frowny specs. So we'll see how he goes. Andy Tennant then with Ron Szilard, known as the Bullet, and finally we get Chris Grassman, and he gets Peter Belain. Peter Belain does look very ghostly, doesn't he? That's the Kaiser. He is a blistery, Derny pacer. Here comes Goldilocks. It's Zak Kovalcik. Looks like he's chewing a toffee. And he gets... Oh, it's Vartan. Kovalcik gets Vartan, wearing number four. They've swapped vests. Just the foxes. There we are. So, that's how it stacks up. Ron Szilard and Chris Latham.
Andy Tennant.
I beg your pardon. Yes, it is Andy Tennant. In fact, the riders are wrong. There we are. It's not Chris Latham. He's not well. It's Andy Tennant. So, Ron Szilard is his man. So nice to see teammates. They've been given P1 here in terms of their position. Well, we selected it. I think they deserve cheering up teammates. Is this going to be the event to do it?
Well, I don't know. It's going to be very hard for Andy Tennant, having been sat in the cabin for the last hour or two, to actually perform and pull a result out. But best of luck to him.
Here we go. Time to roll. Well, I love the sound of the Derny racing, don't you? It's a cacophony in here.
Yeah, it's fantastic. And the lights come up, the smell of the two strokes and the sound as well. It all throws itself to being an absolutely fantastic event.
So, here is Zak Kovalcik. He of the Golden Mane. I don't know where that's where it comes from. Here we are then. One to go before the riders will pick up. I think will they roll them off now to join them? No, not quite. Here we are then. So this time by. And giving them only half a lap grace. I do wonder, to be honest, how they managed to sort themselves out here. Here we are. Dexterous use of revage. 40 laps to go then. Time to go racing.
Yeah, man, the riders, it'll take them a good five or six laps to get up to speed. Much bigger gear on for this event, probably somewhere in the region of 102 to 108 inch gear. Not as big as they would have been using on London, but as we've been saying all night, it's a much tighter track.
There is no flat here, is there?
The straights are very, very long and the bankings are very tight. and the transition drops off very quickly.
Even the straights are banked, dramatically than most here.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
But what I mean is, if you overtake someone on the straight, you've got a long straight to get around someone.
Yeah.
And very little time spent going the long way around in the corner, so to speak.
Yeah, it's going to be all hell breaking loose when we get to the Madison Chase, isn't it?
Yeah, very much so. I mean, it's a blessing in disguise for everybody that it's only 20 minutes tonight, because it takes the pressure off a little bit for the riders, and it takes the pressure off for us as well. It just eases everybody into it while we get used to the certain jerseys and linking those jerseys to the names without having to look down at them.
The nuances, to be honest. Here is Kovalcik. We've christened him Goldilocks at Limahl and just about everything else. But it is Zak Kovalcik, the 2016 National Madison Champion, by the way, from the United States. 33 years of age, he's been around around for quite some time. Twice Pan American medalist as well. So he takes it over the border. An elite national track champion on five separate occasions. So he's feisty and he looks comfortable here. Likewise does Andreas Graf, who's calling for a bit more pace and indeed getting it. Almost inexorably from Rennie Koss, and in fact some very, very good work going on here, and likewise from Andy Tennant. Tennant, who's I guess it's not necessarily an advantage to be sitting out most of the events earlier on, is it?
No, and I think he will have been sat in the cabin there, and the problem is he's going to have to have got on the rollers and got warmed up for this and mentally switched himself back on. And there is a danger that you kind of think, well, if my partner's not well by, you know, the day after tomorrow, we're not in this event anymore. So for me to get up and bend myself inside out to win a race, having not done anything all night, with the threat of not being in the event at all after tomorrow hanging over us, it's a big mental ask.
Well, he's got Szilard in his golden Derny, famed as such, and he's doing a terrific job. They're double-checking each other. Peter Belaine is in the house. I've seen Herman Bakker in this one. But Wally Hubrecht is here. And I think, Volta, you may well see that aero effect. It gets a rippling effect on his chubby chops, doesn't he, when he goes extremely fast here. We'll see. But Andy Tennant and Ron Szilard are eating up the track at the moment. They're doing an absolutely outstanding job of keeping it sensible. Peter Belaine. That is the tash of Chris Dipple, who's also looking more than purposeful. He has got Christian Grassman as his rider in tow here. And that's the point, isn't it? It is in tow. We get some tremendous pace here, far higher pace than the Kieran Derny these days.
Yeah, it's a longer event as well, so, you know, they can really get the pace on there. And the Kieran, it's changed a lot over the years from what it used to be. Yeah, it's a watered-down version of the Kieran for me. But nonetheless, back to the task in hand, and the Derny race, 22 laps, sorry, to go. And this is ticking itself off very quickly indeed. We've got four riders just edging their way away from the other two riders. And this is going to be a fast finish. Don't forget, these riders, once they finish this, have to get straight back up and ride a 20-minute Madison chase.
Chris Dipple has been called for action, and the man who's asked for it is Kenny De Kettler. And here he comes, Kenny riding the track. Now, the riders actually love this event because if you want to read the track, this is the best pace to take it. And I guess they're sort of mapping it all out. Every single bump, it looks nice and smooth out there, but every track has its chatter, doesn't it, as well?
Yeah, it does. Every track has its own little nuances and how to ride it. And the very experienced six-day riders who are used to riding with the Dernies a lot and know the Derny drivers, they won't need to say anything to their Derny driver. The Derny driver will just pick up on how they're doing, how well they're going, and where they want to finish overall, because they might want to have a slightly easier race because they've got the 20-minute chase coming up right after this. But we can see here, rider number six, and that's Andreas Graf coming around the outside. And this race does look like it's bringing itself back together to be a very, very tight finish in 15 laps time.
We've seen four wide, haven't we, on this track?
Yeah.
You know, on this very narrow track. So, off the final curve, you just wait and see. 14 laps to go. And it's Kaltz unfortunately, is going to get mobbed here. And sailing by, Andy Tennant's looking very cool, isn't he?
Yeah, looking good at the moment. And we can just see Michel Vartan out of the picture at the moment. But don't discount him, regardless of what rider he's got on his back wheel. Very experienced Derny driver and world champion in his own right in the past.
So Kenny de Kettler calling for a little bit more pace. And in fact, fastest man out there at the moment is Andy Tennant. Looks nice and relaxed. And you're saying, well, maybe put something in the bank while he was waiting to compete. Chris Latham, we remind you, his partner, that was taken ill after the rider presentation. And as a result, I'm afraid, has been given 3 days to get himself sorted out. Andy Tennant will be contesting some of the single events while he waits for him. So they've got a three-day neutral hanging over them, so they can take a two-day neutral, I beg your pardon. So they will be coming back into the competition, hopefully. But if Chris Latham, if it's a tummy upset, that can really be a leecher in terms of your ability, can't it?
Yeah, I mean, that's about the only thing it can be that means he can get better. If it's a cold or, you know, a virus or the flu and a fever, that's really going to knock him back for a week at the very least. Yeah. If it's a little bit of food poisoning and it's in and out of you very quickly, you can just about recover in time to race. Maybe not tomorrow, but certainly the day after.
Seven laps to go, six now, this time by. I think Christian Dippel looks very, very strong here with Kennedy Kettler. Now, I don't think that they're going to give this as a gift to Andy Tennant, just to keep his pecker up. Not a bit of it. These guys want points, and there's an entire series to be had.
Yeah, it's early on in the event, so you really need to set your stall out. And we can see there, Andy Tennant sat at the front at the moment, being paced by Ron Szilard, but in very close proximity to him, we can see Kenny de Kettler being paced by Christian Dippel. Just with three laps to go now, and it is Andreas Graf as well in the background, being paced by René Kos. It's going to be between these three for the final win.
It is. I think René Kos here may well pick this up. Let's have a look. Kenny de Kettler down the back straight, two to go. It'll be the bell next time by. It might be a three up. Finish this one, we'll see. Three pairings, that is. Andy Tennant responds. He's still got some power here, and it's being wound in. In fact, they're in danger of lapping at a very, very bad time. They come round here. Kenny de Kettler tries to pick it up, but it looks like a fantastic moment, this, for Andy Tennant, is it? De Kettler goes high wide. He's going to trap Tennant down on the banking as they lap other riders. Tennant, though, finds a bit more pace and delivers. Ron Szilard, absolutely outstanding with the golden Derny, picks it up for Andy Tennant. Great ride.
So Andy Tennant, having been sat in the cabin for the rest of the evening, gets up and takes the win in the second Derny race of the night. Andy Tennant there being paced by Ron Szilard, and hopefully we can see Chris Latham back and on the track tomorrow night. So Andy Tennant there being challenged. As you can see just in the background there, black rider number two, that was Kenny de Kettler, and they just couldn't get on terms. As you say, a little bit dangerous, well, not dangerous, but a little bit close on the final lap with a couple of riders being lapped, but all worked out well in the end. And Andy Tennant there takes the win.
Good work. Some of you are really getting into the groove. Cheryl Dunn says, Andreas Graf, he looks good on paper. Cheryl shares my thoughts. There we are. If you'd like to spare yours, by the way, it's at Carlton Kirby or at AGibby76. I think Harry Seacombe was still around there. We're going to take ourselves a break, and we'll be back with more. Congratulations to Andy Tennant, who has just taken the second of the evening's 40-lap Derny race. Manage and Chase is next. Welcome back. It's the 6-day Amsterdam 40-lap Derny result. Andy Tennant takes it ahead of Kenny de Kettler, Andreas Graf, Christian Grassman, Marcel Kautz, and Zak Kovalcik.
Perhaps Zak, but five away. So here we are then. It's Madison Chase time to finish off this lovely evening here in Amsterdam. It's the first of the six that make up this element of the series. It's Madison time, the Madison Chase, to finish off what has been an enthralling opening night of the Amsterdam Six. Tony Gibb, explain.
Well, the Madison Chase, as we've got here, 20 minutes on this occasion, and then we will have a lap board put up when I think there's 50 laps to go. I'm just flicking through the very comprehensive manual that we've got to tell me that. Just one thing, Carlton, going back to the overall that was just up there a minute ago on your screen, the graphic was actually wrong. Because the riders at the top, and I didn't even see who it was because I was looking at the manual to try and work out if it was right or not. The riders at the top, I think it was Depot and De Kettler were, yeah, so they should now be another lap up. So they should be on zero. Morkoff and Hester and Grassman and Byers should be on minus one, and everyone else should be on minus two.
Are you sure they weren't just a lap down and busted with 101?
Positive.
There we are. Okay, so we'll have the amendments rolling through as we get them. If Tony Gibb is right, there we are. It usually is. 54 seconds into this 20-minute event. We'll have a lap count to count us down on this one.
Yes,
as well.
50 to go. So when there's 50 laps to go, which I guess will be at about 15, 16 minutes or maybe a little bit less than that.
Oh, we've got movement already, and it's a big attack already rolling in. Pim Lichtart has decided to pace this one up, and the Spanish have gone with him. Now, this is what it's all about, attempting to gain a lap on the field, but on such a tight track, you can get it quickly, but likewise, your enemies are in full vision as to where you are.
Yeah, you get the lap gains very quickly indeed on a 200-metre track. As we saw earlier, it's only sort of 11, 12 seconds round here at the very most. So don't forget, as we said, 50 laps to go will come up. There's no points within the race, but there's points at the end of the race.
So there we are. We're on an absolute flyer at the moment. Laps to be gained, and Marcel Kaltz wants a piece of this. And in fact, they've gone out on their lone. So big chase down almost immediately. That's Jens Maurice and Pim Lichtart. Don't want this one to slip away from them at all. So we're at the 2-minute mark only, and already all hell is breaking loose. The Spanish responding, just about everyone else as well. Pace is frenetic, Tony.
Pace very quick already. See, no one's actually got away yet. It's being controlled very well at the front of the race. The riders in the orange jerseys, Wim Strottinger and Yuri Harvick, paying close attention to what's going on here. They are probably the local home favourites, although there are four teams from the Netherlands riding here tonight and for the rest of the week.
On board with Grassman, as you saw, just looking back, and you'll see teammates just dropping in here and just rolling. In fact, we've got a full and proper mix. Nice change in the curve by Depart and De Kettler.
And it's Terpstra.
It is.
Terpstra puts in the first big full-blooded attack, being chased down there in the background. It looks like Team 10, Beyer and Grassman, trying to go with them. The big changeover to Roy Peters. Are they going to be able to open up this gap and take the first lap gain? It's being controlled at the moment, and the bunch come back up to them, and it's neutralised already.
Huge response, wasn't it? Well, there's no doubt that Nicky Terpstra throws down an enormous threat whenever he goes for it. Just over the 3-minute mark of this 20-minute run that will make up this final chase this evening. It is the first of all of the six that make up this wonderful element of the six-day series. We're in Amsterdam. More rounds to come, of course, not least Copenhagen and Berlin. And, of course, we have Mallorca to finish off the entire series, which has been outstanding. It's great that six-day racing has found a proper home. And, in fact, that all credit to the organisers. They have done an amazing job, and apparently ambitions to extend the series as well globally.
Yeah, that'd be absolutely fantastic. It's already been a very busy winter, and we've noticed it ourselves, haven't we, Carlton, saying, hey, we've never had as much work in the winter. It's absolutely fantastic. The racing's great. It's going from London to Amsterdam, from Berlin to Copenhagen, and ending up in Mallorca with the grand final, the one-day event, which the top 12 teams, I believe it is, qualify for.
Well, it's only a short chase, this one, of 20 minutes, so points will be awarded at the last, but laps gained do count now, but Torres is looking for them. You can also see that Leif Lampeter here on from the 4 team at the front. He's black 4, Leif Lampeter, his teammate Marcel Kautz is red 4. The teams are split, as Tony was saying earlier on, into colours, coloured numbers, so you have black numbers, thankfully, edged in white, and red numbers as well, likewise, if you're on a red background. So everyone's always clear as to numerically what we're dealing with. Don't look for teammate, though. Chris Latham and Andy Tennant, I'm afraid. You need a pairing to function in this race, and Chris Latham is not well. After the rider introductions earlier on, Andy Tennant has taken the 40-lap Derny race, individual event, of course. So he is scoring points, but he's essentially running on a neutral and waiting for Chris Latham potentially to get well, and we hope that happens, but it's always a tall order. Right now we've got a bit of neutral, it seems.
Yep, and the race very quickly winding down. We're at 5.5 minutes already. It seemed like we only just started yesterday. Don't forget, 50 laps to go will be put up on the board, and I can't see that being much past, what, 12 minutes at this rate, Carl.
At this pace, yeah, I think you're absolutely right. They're gonna call it home. This amphitheatre does have to be cleared before 11. So the party does go on for those who have performed for us this evening. The riders as well just go and take some respite in little social areas, like a little bar restaurant.
No, I was just going to say that the worst thing is with a 6 day, you've raced, you go back to the hotel straight away, and you're absolutely buzzing, and you don't sleep.
Yeah.
You just sit there and stare at the ceiling for, you know, 3 or 4 hours.
Yeah.
So it's better to hang around at the track or go back to the hotel, have something to eat, have a shower, chill out,
yeah,
calm down, let your pulse rate calm down, let your body's core temperature drop a bit, and then go to bed later on.
Yeah, maybe treat yourself some carbs, to be honest. It all helps with the calming process. Tony did that earlier on, by the way. Thanks for the pizza, mate.
You're welcome, buddy. No problem. Good show tomorrow.
All right. Just coming up to the 7-minute mark. No lap count just for the time being. And Yuri Harvick just hits the front, waiting for an exchange. Team 9 as well, you know, with Ray Crader and Nicky Terpstra. They wear the Dutch flag with pride. There's a couple of other orange teams. That's Roy Peters, by the way, who's going up the track. And coming in, Team 3, Jens Maurice, just goes into the void. It's very cagey at the moment. I guess opening night, eh?
Yeah, very cagey. We've normally seen, you know, laps being taken after 2 and 3 minutes. And now, at the moment, no one has gone away whatsoever. So it looks like this one is just going to come down to the 50 laps. There's no big attacks yet, and it looks like everyone's just sort of seen what's going to happen. Nicky Terpstra put the big attack in, that got neutralized, so maybe they've just gone, hey, do you know what, no one's going to be allowed to get away tonight, so we'll just ride ourselves into this one.
I think so. It does have crescendos within the evening. I'm just wondering whether this is going to be one of them. Let's hope it's a grandstand finish, but it's always difficult for the riders to impose themselves on the first night. And the last thing you want to do is burn all your bridges, but all of a sudden Team 4 go for this. And they have been the ones probing constantly, Lampeter and Kautz. And they're on a flyer right now as we just dwell on that group. There he is, flying down the back straight. Now this is a proper effort. And for the time being, there's no response. The Germans are going for this. It's Kautz that takes over from Lampeter, and a lovely throw in. It's about half a lap he's got.
Well, these two between them have won numerous 6 days. Team number 4, Kautz in your picture at the moment, the bigger of the two riders. Lampeter, the smaller, more slight of the riders. They've got half a lap lead at the moment with 8.5 minutes gone in this 20-minute chase. Looks like there's a bit of a response at the moment as Leif Lampeter takes over.
Yes, there is a response. Now, are these guys going to hang out there? It's a 200-metre track, this one, in Amsterdam, so it's shy of the London length, of course. But as you can see, there it is. They are going for this, and there's that's Amora Verdi who's leading the chase at the moment. And you see the variation in the pace depending on where they are upon the track. But they're throwing in beautifully here, and they've got more than half a lap now.
Yep, and it looks like they're going to be able to get back on terms and get this one. They can see the bunch at the end of the straight at the moment. 44 laps to go now, Carlton.
Wow, here we are. We're on lap counts time for timeout this evening. They're going to deal with this in very, very short order, probably about 12 minutes, I would have said, at this kind of pace. Absolutely brilliant run by Marcel Kautz at the moment. Here's the throw. Now, remember, they only have to get to the main body of the pack here, so that means the back of the pack as it starts to fracture and other riders attack. As you can see, there's riders all over the place here, but it's still defined the target group he's going to meet.
Just look at the speed here, Carlton. Leif Lampeter trying desperately to get on terms. Look at the effort he's having to make. This is a big effort on night one of the Amsterdam Six Day to try and get a lap. They're going all out and they're going fast, although that speed there at the bottom of the screen, at the moment their speed's dropping off. There's been such a reaction at the front of the bunch. Are they going to lose this one right at the last minute?
A heartbreak here. Well, Germans get no favours in this part of the world, I'm afraid. And here we are, they sail in and still they're not there. It's undefined. Wait for the Amsterdam Hooter. If he makes it on, it will sound like a super tanker arriving in portside, despite the fact we're just slightly inland here. 39 laps to go. They still haven't managed to tag back on, but I think they're going to make it. And it looks like there's been an acceptance of that by the pack. A little bit of a slowdown, and all of a sudden that gap does get bridged. They're going to make it. Now, Lampeter and Kautz will get on the lead lap, and they'll move into second place because they're on 82 points. So they've got a rack full of points. They will overtake Morkan and Hester on 64. Grassman and Bayer on 58 are also on the lead lap. And so are they with 36 to go here.
That was an awful lot of work to do for a lap gain on night one, and they really are going to have to suck it up and recover now. So on the back of the bunch, we've got Lampeter and Kautz just in front of them. I can't see it now, it's just escaping me, but it's the Austrian team just in front of them. Team number six, Müller and Graf. And the overall fight is going to come down to the sprint at the end. At the moment, it's Kautz and Lampeter in the driving seat with this one. But another big attack goes off the front of the bunch. Look at the pace being put down by Team 2, DePoe and De Kettler.
And it is De Kettler that's fighting for it at the moment. He's got good company as well. Vince Dodgen is also interested. There he is, wearing number one, sails high up, looking for his teammate to make an exchange. Just didn't want to be made a mug of, by the way. Nobody wants to be lent on. The Team 4 that took the lap, Kautz and Lampeter, on policing duties. They have to be, just in case somebody else springs off. And the Swiss are on the attack again.
The Swiss are on the attack, but I tell you what, Team 12, Kovalcik and Hoover, absolutely on the edge of what they're capable of here. Saw him on the front of the bunch and he just flicked his elbows and got out of the way at the last minute. Remains to be seen if they're still in the bunch. I don't think they are. I think they've just been dropped. As Team 11 it is, Imhoff and Margay on the attack here with 29 laps to go now.
They have been so busy. And Tristan Margay, well, he won an event earlier on this evening. They need to as well because, unfortunately, they are a little bit further down the order. So they've got work to do, I'm afraid, and maybe they'll be allowed to do so. Let's see. The Swiss team then, team number 11, currently riding in sixth place. This will help their cause. They'll unlap themselves if they manage to make this stick. 28 to go.
Yeah, but they're not making much progress at the moment. Imhoff, it was there that came up to throw Margan, and Imhoff looked like he was really labouring that gear over. And here we go, 58 kilometres, 60 kilometres an hour at 180 beats per minute with the bunch chasing very, very hard.
Well, look at the pace that's being sustained here, and you can't sustain it forever. Crosses the line right now, and just looking to see whether there's any kind of sit-up from the pursuers. Andreas Graf, is the man who's chasing down the Swiss at the moment, and they're keeping it together as a pack, and this is not helping the Swiss at all. That's the active rider at the moment at the bottom. You see the passive riders, the resting riders, a little bit higher up. You know, there's no respite in any part of this course because you're either, this track, you're either teeing up for a corner or exiting one. It's not a comfortable place to be, Amsterdam. It's great for us, though.
Yeah, absolutely fantastic. And we're coming up to 4 kilometres to go here, 20 laps. And don't forget, in team pursuit in terms, that's less than 4 minutes of racing. So for these guys, we're going to be looking at probably 4 minutes 20, 4 minutes 40 of racing. So not long to go at all. These guys really are going to have to move it if they're going to get this lap gain.
Claudio Imhoff really powering into the curves, as you can see. He's holding a very solid line. Been impressed by the Swiss team, to be honest. They've had some good results tonight.
Yeah, they've had some good results tonight. They had some good results in London as well. One of the teams that I should imagine are going the whole way through this series to try and win the event overall in Parma later in the year.
Yes,
and we
saw
just at the back of the bunch there, Kovalcik and Hoover from the USA just struggling and getting distanced by a couple of lengths. And if that's happening on the first chase of the first night, it's going to be a long week.
I'm afraid it is for Kovalcik and Hoover. We'll see. 18 laps remaining then. These guys are struggling to make this one stick, I'm afraid.
Yeah, and you can see there the difference in speed. They're 5 kilometres an hour slower than the bunch, and that's not going to help them, and that's varying a little bit. But Imhoff and Margay with 17 laps to go. They've been out there a long time as well. We said it was a big ask for Kautz and Lampeter for their lap gain, and they tried very hard to get that. But these guys have been out there a long, long time.
Yes, they most certainly have. Kautz and Lampeter, the only ones to have made it round, and they had to do it on their own. That's something you can at least do here in Amsterdam.
Yep, 3K to go, so just adjust your thinking a little bit on this track. It's 50 metres per lap shorter than the London Velodrome that we saw the London 6 Day on last month. They're just in sight of the back of the bunch now. They've got about 3.25 minutes of racing left, maybe a little bit less now. If the bunch start getting interested in this final sprint, as you can see they are now, it's gone out again.
Yeah, I'm afraid so. It was starting to look like one curve away, wasn't it? But it's all over.
And
13 laps to go, and suddenly everyone's thinking about how they tee themselves up for the finale, and it makes this task all the more difficult. Look for the active riders, not those resting up.
Yeah, and look there, you can see that Margay having to thread his way through resting riders, and that means he's got to constantly have his head up, got to have his wits about him, go around the Americans there that have been dropped. That won't have been he'll note that, and he'll have a word with them later on, because that would have slowed them down.
And
you can see now with 10 laps to go, the front of the bunch only 2 kilometres, getting very interested in this sprint. You know what, Imhoff and Margay here could come out of this finishing almost last overall if they get caught, and that's a lot of work on night one to do to not get a lap gain.
Look at the gap now, it is extending yet again. The Americans stay there. I think they're resting up with our American friends, Team 12, who are a lap down, don't forget. They're just trying to sail into this void, but it's all kicking off out front. And if you have a look at the wider picture here, I'm afraid you're going to find that Claudio Imhoff, who's active right now, has to go round Kovalcik. He will have a word with him over the stompot a little bit later on, I'm afraid. Could possibly have seen that, as they were already lapped. And so now he knows he's got to do it all on his own. 7 laps to go. They're still a long way from what is becoming a very animated pack here.
They're not going to get this. They're going to get caught. The Americans just behind them, still coming around this time. They will have 5 laps to go. 1 kilometre of racing, just over a minute, and they'll get a couple of changes in there as well.
They might be
first over the line if they can manage to hang on, but don't forget we've got Carlton Lampeter already a lap up.
Yeah, so points at the line, but Carlton Lampeter are a lap up, and so they're going to take this one. Let's have a look. 4 to go here. I'm wondering actually whether they're even going to get caught. Let's have a look. They're starting to fade. They're lacking belief, and I'm not surprised. And here come the pack. Well, from nearly getting on the back of them, all of a sudden they're almost going to get mobbed here. Heartbreak, I'm afraid, and look at this, Carlton Lampeter in their pump. They are the leaders of this one, and I'm afraid the pack are going to eat up Imhoff and Margay. Metaphorically speaking, they may well just hang out there a little bit longer. 2 to go, bell's coming up.
See there, Leif Lampeter on the front of the bunch. They know they've got this one safe. All they had to do was make sure that Imhoff and Margay didn't get their lap. Lampeter just sits up to come around the banking. I think that Imhoff and Margay are going to hang on for second. It looks that way.
Wow, well, we have our winners, and what a great effort it was by Carlton Lampeter. They took themselves a lap, absolutely crucially. Arms go up. That is Leif Lampeter. They worked hard for that. More crucially, though, Tony Gibb, they actually timed it beautifully. And you can see what lack of timing can do to you. Imhoff and Margay will be exhausted by that, and it'll knock them back tomorrow.
Yeah, it's an awful lot of work to sit out there for what was 30 laps, probably 35 laps, to try and get that lap gain. And in the end, it came to nothing. Yes, they've got a couple of points for finishing second, but when you look at Leif Lampeter and Marcel Kautz, that'll shift them straight up the overall classification, having taken that lap gain.
Yes, indeed, because they had an absolute rack of points coming into this one. Lampeter and Kautz were on 82 points. Well, we'll have the official result for you in a few moments' time. But a little bit of a chat going on here. And look, the two teams that really animated it. No, a little cuddle being offered up. Lampeter just says to Claudia Imhoff, you had a good go there. I guess it's just a question of fortune. But I think that's proper design by these guys.
So 30 points for the win in the Madison Chase. And everyone gets points right the way down to 13th place. But very little points down the bottom of the field. 30 for first, 25 for second, 22 for third, 20 for fourth, 18th for fifth. And you get the drift going down further down the field.
Super night is the first of the six that make up the Amsterdam Six as part of the six-day series. It's round two, don't forget. We've already had London, Copenhagen and Berlin still to come, along with Mallorca. Here's your Madison Chase standings. Lampeter and Kautz taking a lap and bragging rights as well along the way. Harvick and Stoliger ahead of De Ketelaere and Depailler. Lichter and Maurice in fourth place ahead of Torres and Moriverdi. But what about the Swiss? Imhoff and Margay. I feel sorry for them. They had a really, really tough time there. There you go. My goodness. Well, that looks like our starting rack. But nonetheless, they had a tough time, Imhoff and Margay. And indeed, there'll be more asked of them tomorrow. Well, if you put in too much into one night, you're going to pay for it the next. How do you think the Swiss are going to go tomorrow?
I think they'll be okay. I mean, it's not a particularly heavy program. It's not like they're racing until 2 in the morning and they're not going to be able to sleep properly, and it's the end of the race, it's the end of the week. So I think they'll come around and they'll recover, but it's certainly a lesson learned for them in terms of how competitive this 6 day is going to be, and no one's going to get any easy laps by any stretch of the imagination. And Lampeter and Kautz, they were pretty mercenary in bringing them back towards the end.
They were terrific. And clearly underscoring their credentials for this entire six-day series. It's only the opening night here in Amsterdam, and we cannot wait for your company over the next five still to come. It's great, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely fantastic. And we finish on Sunday afternoon, early again, as usual, for the six-day finishes. And we are here at 7:30 every evening with you.
Yeah, looking forward to it. Hope you are too. So it's time for the riders to retire for their stomp pot. A little bit of mustard mixed in with cabbage and potato. It's hard to beat, quite frankly. We're going to retire as well. Not permanently, I hope you realise. But we will be back tomorrow. This is how it stands up. De Ketelaere and Depailler on 121. Lampeter and Kautz on 112, courtesy of the points they gained just now. Plus a lap, don't forget. Yep. They are the only two teams on the lead lap as we go into tomorrow. Morkov and Hester also very much in the frame. But you've got to feel sorry for those that tried to put something into this and basically came unstuck. Triumph and tragedy every night of the six. Well, should we do it all again tomorrow? Why not? Well, there are our leaders, Murray Depo and Kenny De Ketelaere. But for how long? Amsterdam 6 tomorrow, 20:30 Central European Time. That's 7:30 in the evening in the United Kingdom. We look forward to your company for that. It's going to be terrific. Six-day racing always is. And we've got a six-day series to play with. Amsterdam round two is rocking. We're underway. Day two tomorrow. Bye-bye.